Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for today's panel discussion on quantum perspectives in graduate studies. My name is John Donahue. I'm the Senior Manager of Scientific Outreach at the Institute for Quantum Computing at the University of Waterloo. We're a multidisciplinary research institute studying the potential and the development of quantum information science. Quantum information science is a broad field, with contributions being made from many different disciplines. This includes computer science, mathematics, cryptography, chemistry, physics, engineering, and more. This breadth makes quantum information an exciting field for folks with a variety of interests, but also means there's not just one way to get involved or just one path into the field. We're often asked what the best way to get into the field is or what the best skills to develop are, but truth be told, the great answer greatly depends on what interests you. Whether you liked hands-on experimental work or abstract theory, there are links to quantum information science. At the University of Waterloo, we offer a collaborative graduate program with 7 University of Waterloo departments: chemistry, physics, pure mathematics, applied mathematics, combinatorics and optimization, computer science, and electrical and computer engineering. If you're interested in any of these majors, there's a pathway into quantum research at IQC. We also have a course-based master's in physics that specializes in quantum technology with a heavily emphasized lab component. There are over 30 independent research groups studying different aspects of quantum technology and a community of over 170 graduate students. As a brief aside, if you are in the middle of your undergraduate degree now and would like to try your hand at quantum research, I highly recommend considering the Undergraduate School on Experimental Quantum Information Processing, or USQIP. This is a 2-week program covering the theory and experimental realization of quantum information platforms. When applying for the program, you can also apply for a summer research term at IQC. Applications are open now until early January. Even within the 7 departments, the possible areas of quantum research are quite broad. You can find more information about this on our IQC supervisors page. Today, we'll get a chance to peek into 3 of these areas and learn what it's like to study quantum at the graduate level. We're lucky to be joined by 3 fantastic panelists today, currently studying quantum at the graduate level through the lens of mathematics, physics, and engineering. Each will give a quick introduction of their research and their pathway into graduate studies, and will bring everyone back for a Q&A afterwards. We're also lucky to have Caitlin McDonald, the graduate program manager at IQC, supervising the chat, so please feel free to ask any questions there. Our first panelist is Pablo Palacios Avila, a PhD student in physics and quantum information from the Quantum Photonics Laboratory, led by Professor Thomas Yenivine. Pablo, thank you so much for joining us today.
Hi, John. Thanks for the invitation.
Our pleasure. Please give us tell us a little bit about what brought you into the field and, what kind of research you do today.
Okay. First of all, I want to thank you for the invitation one more time. My first words are related to what I am, what I'm studying. So, first of all, I'm apologizing for my Spanish sometimes, because my mother tongue is not English. I come from Peru. I come from Peru, South America, and I did my undergrad in Peru, my master's in Brazil, and now I'm doing my PhD here in UWaterloo. What brought me here was quantum optics. So as John mentioned before, there are different areas in this IQC like umbrella, and one of them is quantum optics. More specifically, quantum optics and on experiments. So what I do is to try to use experiments and properties of photons, which are the minimum particle of light, to do some experiments related to different kind of projects. Some of them, maybe the most ambitious one, are related to the big project in my group, led by Professor Thomas Yenivine, which is related to the KeySat mission, which is a satellite that can communicate with, make a communication between space and ground for establish some QKD protocol, which means that we use quantum mechanics properties to create a secure key between 2 parties. So what is this important? Because the main goal is that we eventually want to achieve a higher level of security for this establishing two key different 2 parties. This thing about keys is pretty much like we have like a little box or information that we want to share some private information, like your banking or any sensitive information, and we want to have access to that piece of information securely. So one of the ways normally people do that is by having a key between 2 parties. Let's say You have a key, I have a key. Only we it's only both of you we can access to that information. But how can we distribute this key? That's what quantum mechanics does. And one of the properties that allows that is that whenever you measure, you might have heard this before in some point, whenever you measure something with light, the action of measuring affects the state of the quantum of the quantum state, in this case the photon. So you measure something, you destroy something, and you destroying something is because you measure that, or something in the middle measure that, or was lost in the worst case scenario. Anyway, so what I'm doing here is also related to that, but I also explore properties of quantum mechanics in the sense that I want to explore what can we do with when two photons interfere together. So there are very interesting properties about quantum mechanics when photons interfere together. One of them is called Hahn-Mandel, which is one experiment in which we explore how can we combine two photons and get a property that is not having no parallel in classic with classical light. And that's a very interesting property that allows you to create entangled state that are one of the kind of state that are not again had no parallel with any quantum state. And that's another way in which we can enhance the power of the quantum key distribution products, for example. That's what I do normally. Another question that could that was important that I needed to recall for illustrate you what I'm then doing this is what brought me to this to this field, what I am doing experiments. And it has to do with the way that I believe how my learning process work. I mean, it's up to every single individual, but in my case, the way I learned that it works better for me to understand what is going on in nature, what is going on with physics, has to do with the fact that I had the chance of manipulating things, having this intuition of what is going to happen after certain different variations of element in an experiment, and they have the notion that I can do this myself. It's like try to figure this out. Like it's a, suppose that we are a chefs, or or I'm a cook, and I want to prepare a meal. So okay, you have two ways to know how to make the meal, or you can go to the recipe book, or you know, hey, I know if I combine this and that, I can put more of this, more of that. If I want to enhance the flavor, I can use this and that. So you can learn a lot of things by making calculations. Of course, that's valid, and that's okay. But in my case, it's like I feel that making experiments have the power to know what happens if I move this or that, and that gives me a sensation of getting the conceptualization in my mind of what is going on. That's my way of approaching science. That's my way in which I feel that I'm learning science because I'm putting hands on and getting some of the essence of what is this phenomenon about. And that's how we learn doing that's how we learn and that's how we started doing experiments. That takes me back to my undergrad when I did some in experiments in quantum optics. The first time that I interacted with playing with lasers. By the way, the first interaction is amazing. It's getting into the room with a lot of mirrors, a lot of lasers, a lot of pieces of glass. It's really really fun. And also, how can you make different like combinations or paths for making different arrangements for your experiment, or depending on what you want to do? Then in my master's, I explored some about like atomic interactions because the most amazing thing, in my opinion, is when you interact live with atoms, like rubidium atoms or cesium atoms, and the way they react is by generating other emissions. You might have heard about transitions between different levels, atomic transitions. But one thing is to see that in a diagram on the board. Another thing is to see the blue emission, the red emission, the whatever. Infrared, of course, not that fun, but what if it's in the visible region, it's amazing. You can see different colors coming out. Anyway, and how much time I have?
Oh,
Sorry?
you got a couple of minutes.
Okay, perfect. Yeah. And that's what take me to the to get more amazed about my topic. That's the way I learn, the way I feel. And people need to find first what is the thing that they love to do the most, or trying as I did too. I was part of U-Script that mentioned that Joe mentioned earlier, and back then I work on theory. That was fun, and there was many things that I enjoyed doing. But then I decided to do some experiments later on, and at the end I ended up doing what I'm doing the most, which is experiments. So I would say if you want to join quantum, which is, by the way, amazing, depending, no matter what, which area you're picking, if you find a way in which you feel that you're learning the most and you're having fun with this, because this is also a great component, go for it. Quantum information at IQC is one of the best places you can choose for learning this, because you have, as it was mentioned, you have different fields, different areas, and that's very important, I would say. IQC has a very nice environment for interacting with different areas, and even, for example, when you're hanging out in the common areas and you have some colleague, you're carrying some coffee, and you will say, "Hey, I was discussing about this," and maybe your colleague might have another idea that he had come across at some point. You can exchange ideas. This is a very productive environment for having this creativity going on, I would say. And yeah, I would. This is pretty much what I would say for as my first iteration. I'm not sure, I don't want to exceed my time. And I'm here. I'm gonna be here for the rest of this panel.
Awesome. Pablo, thank you so much. We will bring Pablo back in a little bit for the group Q&A. Our next panelist is Adina Goldberg. Adina is a PhD student in pure mathematics from the group of Michael Brannon, who is actually joining us from Germany today. Adina, thank you so much for joining us, and the floor is yours.
Hi, everyone. I'm really excited to be here. Contrary to Pablo, I am not an experimentalist. I am a mathematician. And in fact, just this morning, I was sitting in a room full of people who are, it was a lecture, and the guy talking was talking about a physics experiment with quantum information. And he said, "You know, does anybody in this room, is anybody an experimentalist here?" And I looked around the room, there were about 30 people in there, and absolutely nobody raised their hands. And we all just kind of laughed because I don't know, somehow when you're in theory, you kind of start to get surrounded by people in theory. And I guess something cool about IQC is you tend to bump into people who are outside of your little area, which is exciting. Anyway, so how did I get to Germany halfway across the world doing a quantum information research semester? So I've had like a bit of a non-traditional pathway, sort of. When I was in undergrad, that was like in engineering, and I did this math and engineering program, which it turned out to be like really good preparation for quantum information. But I think at the time, it wasn't so popular. Nobody at Queen's was really working on anything quantum. And I just remember we did information theory. My bachelor's project was on image segmentation, but I didn't really like even, I'd kind of heard of quantum and I was like, oh, that sounds cool, but I don't know what it is. And during undergrad, I did like a couple research projects that were pretty mathematical. One was kind of on like combinatorial game theory, so two people trying to cooperate and you know solve a problem together in like an iterative way. And the other research project was on the value of communication and distributed control. So basically, imagine a bunch of little robots wandering around, and if you restrict how many bits they're allowed to send back and forth, can you kind of quantify how much that improves them being able to reach their joint goal, whatever that is? Okay. So looking back, it's actually crazy that all of the things I was doing at the time really do connect to the stuff I'm doing now, but it took a roundabout way to get there. So after this engineering degree, I really wanted to study math. I was like, oh, the math part was my favorite. I loved it. And everybody I met said, do engineering, it's more practical. You'll get a job. So I decided to do a master's in engineering. I did that at University of Toronto. I was in the electrical engineering department, and my research group worked on information theory. And again, this was classical information theory. We didn't talk about quantum. My research project in particular was on like privacy versus security, and like how those trade-offs look in some authentication systems. And you know, I liked it. The math was really fun. Sometimes in the engineering parts of the presentations, I was like, okay, I'm like less interested. And I regretted a little bit not doing grad school in math, but whatever. That's what people had advised me. That's what I did. And then sometimes you go to grad school and it's not exactly right. And you say to yourself, okay, what am I doing here? And I graduated from that master's program with some difficulty, but then, you know, I was kind of like a little bit like, I'm not sure that I'm supposed to be a researcher. I'm not sure this is supposed to be for me. And I ended up moving to Vancouver for personal reasons, but I got a job shortly after getting there as a college instructor, which really surprised me. I didn't think anyone would hire me to teach at a college, but they did. And I ended up teaching computer science for 2.5 or 3 years to like first year computer science students at a college. It was a lot of fun. I loved it. But you know, after 7 or 8 times teaching the same intro to Java course, you start to ask yourself, like, what else is out there? And all the curiosity that I had about math and all this stuff was kind of like, it was being buried. And at some point I just felt myself like feeling so stagnant. And I was like, I have to do something different. Like I have to go somewhere. And I applied to a few PhD programs, or actually master's programs in math, because I realized like I'd been out of the pure mathematics game for 5 years. Like I really, you know, needed to do something to get back into it. I couldn't just go straight to a PhD. So yeah, and I just applied to 2 programs because I felt like, you know, I had a good background. I had done some research before. I thought I would get in, but I just didn't really know what to expect. I just knew that I had to learn more math. Like that's how I felt at the time. And so I remember Waterloo was one of the 2 places I applied. I chose Waterloo because it's kind of close to Toronto where my family is, but also they had all this other cool stuff going on. Like I knew about IQC and Perimeter, and I was like, oh, there's cool physics stuff. Maybe that will be interesting. I don't know. And when I visited, I just saw the place and I was like, wow, this is a nice city. Like I would be really happy to live here. It's weird. Like I'd always heard of Waterloo, like as an undergrad and stuff. And I was always like, I don't know. Like it doesn't sound fun. But once you go there, you're like, oh, this is a beautiful city. Anyway, so I met with a few people and I told them I had a background in communication theory and like game theory stuff. And they've recommended that I speak to these 2 professors in math who were working on basically quantum information theory, but from a math perspective. And their names are Vern Paulson, who's recently retired, but he was my advisor when I started, and William Slofstra. And I talked to them and I was kind of like, okay, I'm sold. You know, it seems fun. It's like it's a math problem, but it has applications and you can kind of throw little instances of it in a programming language and try things out, but you can also make these really big deep theories about it and it's connected to some really deep math, and all of those things really excited me. So I guess that's how I decided to start at Waterloo. I did the master's program, which was 1 year, and it was a lot of work. It was crazy. And then I decided to stick around and I really liked what I was doing. I'm now doing a PhD in pure math. Switched advisors in the middle. COVID happened in the middle. I got a concussion for the past year and I'm trying to figure that out, but mostly better now. So it's been a crazy journey, but you know, here I am. And so I'll tell you a little bit about what I work on and then that will be all. So my research. So what I really like about my research is I get to use like some very deep and theoretical tools from pure math, but I get to work with a very hands-on type of area and it all has applications in like a very cutting edge area of physics. So the tools that I use are from category theory, in particular tensor categories. And I'm not expecting anybody listening to know what that is, but I guess what I'll say about it is that the little picture I have in the bottom left-hand corner is actually a real picture that I'm working on right now. And what I really like about tensor categories is that instead of using algebraic equations to express what's going on in them, it's a lot more elegant and convenient to express what's happening in terms of diagrams. So I've been having a lot of fun playing with these diagrams and learning how they are actually really perfect tools to model like quantum phenomena. So that's very exciting. The other mathematical tool that I use a lot of the time is C-star algebras, which is basically if you've ever worked with n by n matrices, or if you've ever worked with functions on a set or complex numbers, these are all examples of C-star algebras. And yeah, it's another mathematical tool that's in my toolbox. And what I use these things for is to represent and like work on the theory behind non-local games. So non-local games has been like a super hot topic in the past couple of years. It's gotten a lot of attention because, so first of all, what is a non-local game? So non-local games are essentially, there's these two people and they're not allowed to talk to each other, but maybe they have a pair of entangled qubits, maybe, okay? And each of them will get a question. A question will just be some number, some letter, some bit, whatever, just a classical piece of information. And they'll both, maybe they can measure their qubit, they can do some sort of computation, and then without communicating, they can reply an answer. And then whoever the referee is or the judge will decide, did they give a correct pair of questions to the pair, or sorry, did they give a correct pair of answers to the pair of questions? So it seems like a really random setup, like why is that really important? But the reason it's so important is that this basic question about how well they can do, like statistically, in a non-local game, given access to this shared resource, so this pair of entangled qubits. So first of all, they can do better, this is a spoiler alert, they can do better than they can do classically for certain games. Like if they weren't able to communicate and they had no quantum measurement access, like they do like kind of 10% worse on average, even using their best strategy, okay? So this is kind of a crazy fact, and this really got me interested in non-local games. And so the reason they've become so popular lately, and I know my time's up, so I'm just gonna say this last thing. The reason they've gotten so popular lately is because they've actually been used to distinguish between different models for like physical reality of how quantum information works. So even this simple, tiny mathematical thought experiment can be used to understand, like in reality, if we write down infinite dimensional spaces or finite dimensional spaces or something else, like which mathematical model actually models reality? So I'm excited, happy to answer some questions later, and let's go on to the next person.
Thank you so much, Adina. We actually had one question about your work from Amir. How do C-star algebras relate to more familiar topics like linear algebra?
Yeah, that's
or
a great
question.
Relationship? Yeah, C-star algebras are kind of built on linear algebra. The word algebra just means you have a vector space that also has multiplication. So that should be familiar concepts too, if you're familiar with linear algebra. And so essentially C-star algebra is like builds on top of linear algebra. It adds an extra star operation and some extra stuff, and then you do more things.
Yeah. Awesome. No, sounds good. All right, so we are going to move on to the next speaker, but we'll bring Adina back very shortly as well. Our final speaker of the session is Jack DeGooyer. Jack is a master student in electrical and computer engineering from Michael Reimer's Quantum Photonics Devices Lab. Jack, thank you so much for joining us today.
Awesome. Thank you so much as well. So I'm just going to begin by talking about how I got into quantum, which it sort of came slowly as time went on. So I did my undergraduate degree in electrical engineering at Dalhousie University in Nova Scotia. That's where I'm from, Maritimer, true and true. So I'd originally worked in some summer labs, which I highly recommend for any undergraduate student who's wishing to pursue either even a career or graduate studies. But I worked in some summer labs on ultrasound and FPGA, and kind of got into sort of the design and how of trying to work on sensors and trying to like measure sort of the world around you. And what I was always interested in was how fast you could do that. So you can measure the world around you, and that's something that's important. But how fast can you do that? Like how quickly, how fast, how good can you time sort of the world around you? And this led me this question to my first co-op at the co-op program at Dalhousie, which is at Triumph, where I built a photodetector for something called muon spectroscopy, which was really fun in its most part. It was my first interaction with really, really fast signal processing. So working on the electronics that interact with the signals coming out of a photodetector, as well as kind of just conceptually understanding what is light, which is a really hard question, but sort of how light turns itself into electrical signals and how those electrical signals propagate through a system. From there, I worked on a capstone project, which is on high frequency ultrasound for subsea communication, actually to communicate between fish tags for tagging fish, I guess that's how you'd say it. But for that there as well, I really got into sort of the understanding and design of amplifiers and integrated circuits, and just understanding, you know, as an electrical engineer, how electrical engineering sort of works. And I took a combination of those ideas, and actually for 16 months worked at Tesla using the ideas of data processing for fast analog signals. I used it to try to find minute charging instabilities in data that came out of when you charge and discharge batteries, to try to diagnose if a battery was likely to be unstable. I think that's the proper term to use, but see if the battery is going to explode. So I spent most of my undergraduate degree really focusing on fast signals and how just very, very small differences in those signals can constitute a lot of different information. And so that doesn't really come across as being quantum, I would say. Like that's not entirely, you know, superpositions and entanglement and so on. But when you start to keep on pushing further and further between going faster and faster and faster, what you end up kind of finding is that you do hit a certain thing called the uncertainty principle, where you can't really go much faster without losing something else. And once you hit that edge, I was very interested in that because, you know, it's the fastest that you can process signals, the fastest, you know, for the modality that you're using, there's certain limits that come to it. And when working to try to achieve those limits was something that was super interesting to me. So I can say that I got into quantum without really getting into quantum. I just liked really fast signal processing. I actually never took a proper quantum mechanics course until I came to the University of Waterloo. Most of my schooling before was just on all the mathematics of signal processing, which actually works out really well for quantum mechanics. So, you know, don't feel too discouraged if you haven't done as much quantum as you want to be, because I sure did not. My research focuses mostly on combining, I do cameras. So I do the electronics that come on the back of cameras in our laboratory, the Quantum Photonic Devices Laboratory at the University of Waterloo under Dr. Michael Reimer. We, the other people on the team, have developed a photodetector, a metamaterial photodetector that is capable of absorbing single photons through what's called an avalanche photodiode. It's called a metamaterial photodetector because it's a photodetector that's capable of, it's made out of material that doesn't work, I guess, in the same way as a big sort of chunk of it. It's been it's been processed in a way to have a nanostructure in it, which allows it to be really, really good at detecting light. It's 100% or 99. Whatever percent absorbing of light, which is really good when you're trying to make a camera. And we've also made it, or people in our lab have made it, so that it's able to even work if a single photon hits the detector. It does something called avalanching, which for me means I get a very nice peak signal that I have to process. So the photo on the left there of what I work on, which are these line cameras. So you can make one pixel camera, that's always fun. Why not make a whole line camera where you have 1,000 pixels in a row? You know, that's more interesting there. And they work both classically, just like a regular camera does, and also as an avalanche photodiode, or single photon avalanche photodiode, where in which if a single photon comes in, it smashes it and it causes what you can kind of see there in the photo, an avalanche of electrons to come through, which comes out as a signal peak. So I have a couple photos on the top there, just like some signally kind of stuff. That's what I work on just day to day, is trying to make sure that the information and the electrical signals that come out of the photodiode are useful. And we use those actually, just the entire system together, for 3D imaging, for biomedical imaging applications, actually the back of people's retinas, which is really cool. So altogether, I'm super interested, super passionate about the projects that we work on, because you can really see how not only quantum affects people's day-to-day life, but for that matter as well, just how non-quantum it seems to really, like as you work towards your project, you don't think it's quantum, but then you realize that the faster you go and the higher that you try to jump, you start hitting those limits where you really need to consider quantum mechanical effects. I also want to just quickly talk about the collaborations that I do it here with other universities, just because I think it's always fun to talk about. So on the left there, I just want to say that we work with, our laboratory works with UBC SciEpic to try to design photonic integrated circuits so that we can sort of, it's like making railroads for light to go on, which allows you to do quantum computation with it. So I just have kind of there that we're working on what's called a quantum process design kit, so that people across Canada can make quantum computers sort of just by sort of on their own. I mean, you need all the equipment to really make the things work, but they're able to just start the designing process on their own. And on the right there, we work with the University of Sherbrooke to help host conferences so that there's a conference coming up next year, the Canadian Graduate Quantum Conference, that's going to be involving students from across Canada to just sort of engage with each other over our quantum mechanics and quantum devices and quantum theory, which is obviously really fun. It was canceled because of COVID a couple years ago, and so we're bringing it back. So that's really all I have to present for today, just that I'm not the average quantum person. I'm a quantum engineer, I think is the way in which we use the words for it. But I got here just by finding that as you try to get closer and closer to the limits for engineering, you start hitting what is effectively the quantum limits of the world. And that's always fun to be working at.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Jack. With that, I would like to invite all of the panelists back for the Q&A. So my first question, the chat box is open, by the way. If you have any questions for the panelists, please feel free to put them there, and we'll get to as many as we can in the remaining time. My first question I'll direct at Pablo to start. I find that when you're in graduate studies, a lot of people, parents, let's say, might say, oh, you're just still in school. But of course, being in graduate studies is a lot different than being an undergrad. So how does your day-to-day look like as a graduate student? And how does that differ than what you were doing as an undergraduate?
One day I was told, when I was starting my grad studies, someone told me, you're used to solve problems, and at the end, you're used to receive the solution of your problem that you were assigned to. This is not the case. You're solving a problem, and they might have an answer. It might have an answer. It might not have an answer, or might continue being an open question. So that's pretty much the general state of the situation. You're challenged with different scenarios, different issues that might occur. In my case, for example, my experiment is not working because of this, because of that, or some piece is not doing its job as it should, or the theory doesn't fit to what I found, which could be something amazing or could be just something misleading. Yeah, there are different kind of scenarios that you can come across in different scenarios. So that's pretty much the status of what you're doing. Of course, you take courses. That's also part of that. But most of your time during your grad studies is going to be related to do your research, to solve this problem, this big question that you're facing all the time in different contexts. So that's pretty much the main takeaway that I would say. You're supposed to use all your resources, not only, let's suppose that you're taking a course on course on A and course on B, but then the problem that you're facing has to do with A and B at the same time, or you need to find a way in which that you can use concept from this and that in order to solve this problem. So it's more, I would say, interdisciplinary challenge in some way, interconceptual challenge, I would say too. For example, me as an experimentalist, I needed to learn some of like mechanical engineering stuff, control theory. For example, for locking a laser, we need to learn something on control theory because it's a loop that we need to control. So we need to learn something about electronics and also about something about control theory that it's this loop again. Electronics, of course, we need to do some soldering sometimes. We need to repair some components. We need to make our own components for making some very customized tasks. Yeah, so it's like learning every day by solving different problems, different challenge. But I would say it's not to be scared of, I would say, because the first thing that I was thinking when I was going to face something about like mechanical designing or so, it was like, would I be able to face this? Would I be able to do it? Would I be able to build that thing? And after a while, you learn that every single individual that had to face that, they felt the same in some way. And it's just a matter of building up different layers of concept over and over. And at some point, you're going to discover that you learned this thing. After one thing that happened, especially when I give like presentations, it's like when I give a presentation, especially these that are for like more general public, it's like I need to look back on all the things that I've done. And I realize, hey, I think I've done something. I didn't realize until I presented this. So yeah, I don't want to exceed my time, but just to say that it's a different combination of things, I would say. has ups and downs sometimes, but I would say that they, on average, the major takeaway I would say is that it's amazing from all the point of view you can imagine.
Awesome. Adina, do you in the from the mathematical point of view, what does your day-to-day look like and how does that differ from what you might have expected when you were an undergrad?
So similar to what Pablo said, like in undergrad, things came in neat packages, and that was very satisfying to me as a person who likes sort of the elegance of a lot of the figured out mathematics. And now that I start like shoving my head against things that aren't really figured out, I have this like deep desire to like force them into these elegant packages because they're not in there. And that's kind of even what I'm doing. Like all of my work is centered around making things elegant and making things simple. And I don't know. That's one way to deal with the messiness. Everybody has their own approach, but it's messy. But yeah, in the day-to-day, like actual life, it's a lot different. I'm a huge extrovert and I love to be around people. And so I found that like in grad school, sometimes, especially during COVID, and especially in math, there's not always like a lot of collaborative work to be doing. You have to do a lot of work on your own. So I found that like finding ways to connect with people about math, like taking the initiative to actually poke someone and say, "Hey, I want to chat with you about this thing." Like that takes a lot of initiative, and also just managing your time. Like your schedule is very flexible, which is nice, but also like you really have to take care of like creating a space for doing research, especially if you're just research just looks like, "Oh, I go with my tablet and I scribble some things down," you know. It's easy for that to fall to the bottom of your list. So you really have to like push that to the top of your list. And in undergrad, it was just like all the deadlines, you know, you're just forced to work in a different way, I think.
Absolutely. Jack, what about on your side? How does your day-to-day look, and does it kind of match what past Jack would have assumed from undergrad?
So past Jack did an engineering degree, and one thing about engineering degrees is that you have your head down the whole time. You're just sitting there, you're pounding through six courses a term and so on, and you never really feel like you're really thinking for yourself. And then you go to grad school and you're sitting there, and while the courses are hard and you learn a lot more for it, especially someone like me who has to kind of bootstrap a lot of my understanding of quantum mechanics, is you realize that you have sort of not so much time to think, but more ability to self-direct yourself and the problems that you want to pursue. And so when you have, you know, a master's thesis or a PhD thesis, I have no idea for PhD, but definitely a master's thesis, when you're just trying to figure out what the scope of what you're trying to do is, you're really giving yourself an opportunity to do research in something that you're passionate about. That's something that I would say is different from my undergrad experience. So for the most part, I'm no longer really taking, you know, your mandatory courses, and you're just going through, and you're trying to survive. Instead, I'd say that you're giving yourself an opportunity to thrive.
Awesome. All right. So we have a question from Savin in the chat. Caitlin will provide some detailed information about the actual procedures in there. But Adina, you were mentioning how when you were applying to grad schools, you talked with a few of the professors here and got really interested in the non-local games ideas from those. How do you go about finding a research supervisor, and what sort of things should you be looking for as a potential graduate student when looking for research supervisors and research groups?
Okay, so here's a few tips. Every department is different, first of all. So most of what I know applies to pure math. But pure math has a grad visit day, which was really valuable. You can come to the campus before you're actually there and talk to people. Undergrads is, or not undergrads, sorry. Graduate students will tell you about what it's like working with their advisors. That's a huge resource. And you can also meet the profs. So that can be really helpful. And then a lot of people, like professors are nerds. They just love to chat about what they do. So if you just ask them an exciting question, like unless they're extremely busy at the time, they'll probably be excited to tell you a little bit about it, especially if you show some knowledge that you have looked up something they did or you have a specific question for them. So if you want to talk to a professor, my advice is don't spam them, don't bother them, just, you know, find a way to ask them like a meaningful question and see where they go with it.
Awesome. Jack, what about yourself? How did you go about finding a research supervisor, and what would you recommend to students in the middle of that process?
So I went through obviously all the directories And one thing that supervisors really should realize is that their website matters a lot. I don't know if they realize that, but going through websites and so on, and then reaching out to professors and asking specifically, not only so much for the prof, but I think it's really important to talk to the graduate students who are under them as well. And so you can send a message to the professor saying, hi, I'm really interested in your lab. Could you or one of your graduate students speak to me about it? And most times out of that, you know, whatever, the supervisor is going to send one of their graduate students to accomplish the task. And so that was one thing that I spoke to a whole bunch of graduate students from different universities across the continent. And that was where I got most of my perspective for it. Because, I mean, for the most part as well, I really enjoy my supervisor. He's a really, really great guy. But you can figure out when talking to, like, obviously you want to go to graduate school, you really have a passion for it, but you have to be very careful that not all supervisors are created equal. And so when talking to some of the students, you can kind of figure out whether or not that supervisor is someone that they really are inspired by, or someone that they're just trying to work under to finish their degree. And I think that's something that is really important when looking out for supervisors. So everyone, UR-Lu is great, but definitely when speaking to some other institutions, you could tell that when they have there's some supervisors who have, you know, 30, 40 students under them, and they barely even talk to their prof. So you're trying to figure out what perspective that really is for the most part. Yeah.
Thank you. Pablo, what about yourself? How did you go about finding a supervisor?
In my opinion, I would say that there are different components. First of all, I would say that from the perspective of applying directly, maybe people are aware, but there are two streams. The regular stream, which is like filling all your paperwork, all that, your application itself. And the other stream is the informal stream, in which you start emailing profs and trying to contact them and try to see if they are interested in you. Because these two need to go in parallel, because I'm not totally aware of what is this process going on in the university, but it's like there's a pool of applications, and the supervisors, they have like an idea of who are they hiring eventually. So this is like something that I would go all the time, like having a look of or make yourself visible, make yourself like you're there, that like you're interested and you want to, you express some interest on working on his or her group. That's what I would say. That's one component. The other component is, of course, you need to find out is if the research fits to what you're looking for. But I will also say that even though, try to explore more about the area, because, for example, one of the things that I did during my master was I wanted to do more quantum optics, but then I realized that they were doing more about atomic things. And I ended up enjoying that even more in some way. So I would say that even though you're not totally familiar to the topic, try to give it a dig on that. Try to explore more about that. And maybe you will find something even better that you were not knowing. I mean, we are as undergrads, we don't know all that is out there for us to be in research. I mean, maybe for me it was more about like what other areas I can do more experiments with. For Adina, could have been like, I have no idea what is this like complex math that I will eventually deal with. So it's like, how can you be more aware of what you will aim to do unless you dig a bit more, or try to knock on doors on other colleagues? Or another thing is like, why don't you also try contacting other colleagues in that group that you're interested in? Maybe they will tell you, hey, seems like this is something I would like to do, but could you tell me more? I mean, and this is something that it's mostly a fact. When we are reaching PIs, something that is kind of annoying is that they are not precisely good people in responding emails. So they might have like a great stack of emails that are piling over and over, and it's very easy to get your message lost among all these big piles. So don't get frustrated if you are not read. It's like something that happens all the time. But I would say that don't give up, continue moving on in that direction. But also you can try contacting other colleague members in that group. Maybe they have more time, more insight from what it's like to be in that group. That's something that I would also say about how to reach supervisor, because it's not only about the supervisor. Sometimes the supervisor can not be directly supervising you all the time. He might be there anyway, but maybe the amount of time that you will spend will be more with maybe a postdoc or some other colleague that might be more handy there for solving any like regular situation, especially if you are like starting your grad studies. So I would say it's not the takeaway is not only think about the supervisor but also the work environment, because the synergy and the dynamics is also important. So pay attention to that too.
Awesome. Thanks. So we have a couple of related questions, one from Amir and one from Physics Perspective, wondering about what background is needed to kind of break into this field a bit. So for example, Amir is looking at breaking into experimental quantum optics, but has a bit of a background in more theory. Are there any skill, I'll start with Jack on this one. Are there any skills that you would recommend students build up in their undergraduate before going into graduate studies in your particular field? Is there anything that they should be building up at this time, or should they be worried about things like that?
It's hard to figure out what you need to know, because you can try your best to prepare for whatever scenario is going to come, and then it comes and you realize that maybe you spend a little bit too much time studying for one thing that you never really use. So to a certain extent, I think being nimble is always important for it. In particular, you really can't go wrong with linear algebra when it comes to quantum mechanics. That's for the most part as well. And picking yourself up, I mean, I have it actually right next to my desk. Just your introduction to quantum mechanics, Griffith's book, is always useful as well. That for the most part, I think, is what I did, and I didn't feel too far behind from it as someone who really didn't do any quantum mechanic courses before getting into this topic. When it comes to your particular research, you're probably competent at all the stuff that you have from undergrad, but for the most part, Griffith's textbook and linear algebra is all you need, at least for me.
All right, Pablo, same question. Are there any particular skills that if someone was, say, interested in joining your group that you would recommend they beef up on, or
I would say if you're into theory, it's not like experimentalists, we don't need any theory. I mean, I would say quantum mechanics, quantum optics is one of the areas in which theory and experiments are more connected, because we run simulations all the time. We try to see how the theory is going to be reflected on the experiment. So maybe this area in particular is more close. It has a smaller gap between theory and experiments. We are really close to one another. Therefore, knowing theory is very essential, crucial, if you want to have a better understanding of what is going on. So we need to review all the time different things. For example, one of the things that I'm working on like these days is like a collaboration with Michael Reimer, Jack's supervisor, in which we use their single photon source for running Hohmann mandel, the experiment that I mentioned before. But the thing is that the single photon source that they have is a quantum dot. And the quantum dot is a very particular source. It has different things that are not precisely the ones that we're familiar with. I need to study a lot of the different effects by which, so just in short, the way the photon is emitted is by creating different levels, transition levels that are created by charges, the electrons, the conduction band, and so. And these charges might be affected by the surrounding charges. The problem is that this, when it comes to the experiment, it leads to problems in the pattern that I was aiming to. That's something I needed to learn more. And I needed to go to books. I needed to study the theory. What is this like problem going on? What is this about? And I needed to go to books, I needed to read the theory, I need to like do some calculations. So not quite, it's like if you're doing experiments, that's gonna be the end for you doing math, doing calculation, going to a board and try to make some scribbles. Not totally. You will always need to do some theory, you will always need to do some calculations and simulations. So I would say don't disregard the theory component of being experimentalist. Because we need that so much. We don't just run experiments just because we wanted some. We need to have some foundations. So I would say there is a lot of theory in experiments.
Silly. And then Adina, are there, if someone wanted to break into your field, would there be any fundamental research skills that they need going into it? Or is that something they can also pick up as they go?
So I've got to say, first of all, I've seen people from all over the place, and I think a bachelor's degree in physics, engineering, or math is adequate preparation for any kind of quantum stuff, as long as you have the right attitude. So my three tips to people would be, number one, to get comfortable being uncomfortable. I think that's one of the most important skills that you have to have. Number two would be to get comfortable being wrong, which is kind of part of the first one, maybe. And number three is to practice asking questions, even if you feel like the answer might be obvious. Just ask a lot of questions, because that's the only way you're going to get anywhere. Like, you can't be worried about embarrassing yourself. Yeah.
Awesome. All right, so we have another question from Physics Perspective, wondering about events, opportunities. I'll maybe broaden that to also include just general resources. If someone is interested in breaking into the field, is there anything that you would recommend for them to learn more about what's out there, for them to learn some ideas about what research is out there? Any resources, be it academic, that you would find helpful? Pablo, I'll throw that one to you first.
Okay, it's not a secret that being a grad student can be sometimes stressful. So it's a component, not the end of the world. It's something that it's there because, I mean, it's sometimes a lot of pressure, a lot of like things that you need to think about, or even yourself. In my case, it's pretty much myself that I like pressure myself because I like to get more results, or something doesn't work for experimentalism that's happening that is not up to you. It's about the experiment or about the component that didn't arrive or something like that. So one thing that I would encourage is to find other ways to disconnect yourself, because work is not 100% of your time. It shouldn't be, I would say, because the way in which you are more creative is by having all yourself or your brain working perfectly in synergy, one region with the other. So one of the things, for example, that I do is I'm practicing salsa. That's something I like to do a little every time I can. I go to the gym. Sometimes I like to sing, not very well, but I give it a try. And of course, hanging out with friends is also amazing. Having this space for interacting. And for example, one of the things that we didn't mention about QC, we have like free cookies every day at 4, and that's very important for making different interactions coming along. And it might sound fun, but I would say that a couple of good ideas that I came up with occur in the cookie time, because you have the time for interacting with other people, then maybe from older experimentalist point of view or theorist point of view, they might have some other insights or other opinions, and that interaction opens your mind to different other things. So you might not believe the amount of creativity that might occur sharing a coffee or sharing a good moment with other friends. Having these like spare moments could be also the source for good creativity. At the end, it's not only about being good at math, being good at physics, being good at chemistry or whatsoever. It's about being creative. It's about being disruptive, as people normally say nowadays. Is it the fact in which you can come up with new ideas that can be like pointing in a different direction that no one has explored before? That's the main goal. So people would say people in grad school are geniuses or so. Some of them are, I would say, but it's not only about that, I would say too. It's about being creative, you know, being imaginative. Hey, why if I plug this and there? Has anyone done that before? No. So why don't we? Well, let's give it a try. Things like that. I would go that way. So to wrap up, the idea of having interaction with other people is important, and also disconnecting yourself from the routinary work. Going to your computer, typing all the day, writing scribbles, and doesn't work. Disconnect yourself, plug yourself later, it will work.
Awesome. Adina, what about yourself? Are there any resources, be they academic or social, that you find helpful as a grad student?
I'm not sure what you mean by academic resources, but I guess like for me, I would first and foremost agree with Pablo that like taking myself out of the academic setting and like I go rock climbing a lot, or I used to before the concussion. And yeah, just taking time to like do things that are, I mean, as a mathematician, it's like very mental, like you don't even use your hands very much. Even like the feeling of writing on a chalkboard is sometimes a relief because I'm like, I'm using my body in some small way, you know? So just, I think it's important to like try to focus on yourself as like a whole person, and it actually makes you a better graduate student. And then financially, I would say applying for scholarships is huge. Like I've been funded my entire academic career, and like I, you know, worked hard on a lot of scholarship applications, but it makes it way less stressful, and I've had to take on a bit less TA work as a result. Like there's just a lot of things that like make life a lot easier because of that. And so don't procrastinate on the scholarship applications, like do them, get them in. Even if you feel like you might not get it, just do it. Do it again, you know? Yeah.
Right. Awesome. And Jack, same question to you.
Cool. I think the way I would interpret this one, because I agree with everything said before, like definitely you gotta treat it. I've heard some people say treat grad school like a job. Which is true. You still are in school, but you gotta make sure, I think, in a certain mentality that you don't spend, you know, all your nights till 2 a.m. studying or working, because that's just a great way to burn out. That's not good for anybody. I'd say at least trying to say something different is that it's important to ask questions, but also especially when you're new to grad school, don't be afraid to ask questions, because it's not that you're incompetent, you just don't really understand entirely how certain things might be set up. The things that might be obvious to everyone around you that you know are obvious but you don't know, it's important to ask those questions early on and go for it. You can spin your wheels in grad school for, you know, even up to a week for something without realizing that you might be stressed about something that, you know, part of your experiment, part of your thesis or so on. You might waste so much time on it and then speak to your supervisor and realize, oh, that actually wasn't that important and so on. So I think just mostly, and it goes to, I think, saying about the cookie time as well and chatting with folks, make sure you ask questions, but don't be afraid to look like an idiot when you do it.
Awesome. All right, so we are in our last couple minutes. I'm gonna throw one last question out there. If someone from the audience was able to join you in person and you got to show them one cool thing about being a grad student, what would be that one cool thing? I don't know if, since this one's kind of off the cuff, does anyone want to volunteer to go first? Or what would you say is kind of the coolest thing you get to do being a grad student?
Okay,
I would say we have a lot of cool lasers, different kind of lasers. They are amazing. They are so powerful, and you need to be careful with them too. But yeah, they're really cool. Once you get into the lab and you see all the different toys that you will play with for making your experiments, that's amazing.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's very cool to play. And it even looks cool sometimes when you need to wear the goggles. Like you feel like a rocker or DJ playing with all the mirrors and things like that. Yeah, it's very cool.
Yeah, awesome. I do always love going into a lab and figuring out what's the most dangerous thing, and that's probably going to be the coolest piece. All right, Jack?
I was going to say laser too. I had to reevaluate my question as well. It's terrifying. You show people around the lab and you just go, oh, yeah, don't look at that laser. That one will burn your retinas clean off if you try. Just don't bend down. For me, it would be in our laboratory, we're starting to work with something called silicon photonics, which I showed in our presentation, which is when you can take an entire lab bench of optical equipment and then condense it down to something that's the size of a microchip. So just like, you know, holding up, here's the computer that's in a room versus here's the computer that's on your finger. That's kind of the fun thing that I would probably show if I had the chance.
Right. And Adina?
I think it's tied between getting paid to draw little pictures and the other cool thing. I mean, this is just in my mind because it happened to me like 2 days ago. Somebody I didn't know came up to me and mentioned a paper that I had written and asked me about it. And I was like, this is the most amazing, exciting thing. Like, I feel like maybe I'm a mathematician, you know?
No, absolutely. Awesome. Well, Pablo, Adina, Jack, thank you so much for joining us this afternoon. It's been an absolute pleasure, and thank you for answering the questions and talking about your experience. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you to everyone who joined us today. Please follow us on social media to keep an eye out for future panels. We will be running a panel on quantum simulation in December. We'll also be running more editions of our Quantum Today series, talking with researchers at IQC about their research. Until then, thank you so much for joining us again. Have a wonderful week. And if you do have any further questions about graduate programs at IQC, please visit our website. We have a list of our programs there, as well as contact information if you do need to ask any questions. Thank you so much. Have a wonderful weekend and happy Halloween.